Good morning, one and all. Today we are continuing the 10th session, class number 2 by Dr. Alka ma'am, Professor, Department of Rachana Sharira, JSS Ayurvedic Medical College, Mysuru. Before the session starts, I'd like to call Ms. Ritika Kapoor to deliver the prayer.
आदिदेवं सुरासुरी वंदितं पादपादनं लोके जरारुके भय मृत्युनाशं तथार्मिशं विभिर्षधीनां धन्वंत्री प्रमानातम सर्वरोगे निवारितम आयुर्वे प्रवक्तारम वंदे पीयूषम दायकम सर्वे जना सुखिनो भवन्तु सर्वे सन्तु शांति शांति शांति।
थैंक यू मिस रतिका। सो ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ रचना शरीरा एंड शिवा आयुर्वेदिक मेडिकल कॉलेज वी ऑल विश यू अ वेरी हैप्पी टीचर्स डे डॉक्टर अलका मैम।
थैंक यू थैंक यू।
So the platform is all yours, ma'am. You can continue your session.
Yes. So shall I start or no?
Yes, ma'am, you can.
So yesterday we had seen just good morning, everybody. And from myself, those who are teachers, for them, a very, very happy Teachers' Day. So yesterday we had seen uterus, fallopian tubes in detail, and we discussed also. Today we are going to just discuss or learn remaining these parts of female reproductive system, that are ovaries, vagina and external genital organs. So first, it is very much important organ is there, that is ovary. The ovaries are female gonads, the female gametes called oos. Ovaries are female gonads and female gametes, which are going to nothing but here female gametes, which are called oocytes, that are formed in the ovary. So male gonads are testes, female gonads are ovaries. Situation of the ovary, see carefully, it's very much important. Ovaries lies in the ovarian fossa, in the viva, in oral exam. Examiner is asking what is the location of ovary. So it's a very much important. Each ovary lies in the ovarian fossa on the lateral pelvic wall. The ovarian fossa, so what is the ovarian fossa? It is a space which is bounded by anteriorly by obliterated umbilical artery. See carefully, there is blue color, this umbilical artery which is obliterated in fetal circulation. Mostly you had studied that after the birth, the umbilical artery, umbilical veins, they are going to obliterate and they are going to become a ligament. So anteriorly it is bounded by nothing but umbilical, obliterated umbilical artery. Posteriorly by the ureter and internal iliac artery. See carefully, the large, there is internal iliac artery is there. Common iliac artery divides into internal and external. So see carefully, that's the internal iliac artery, plus just there is below, there is again side, there is ureter is there. So ureter and internal iliac artery. Position of the ovary, before this figure you see, and then we will discuss. In nulliparous woman, It nulliparous woman means, yesterday I told you, the woman who not given birth to children, long axis of ovary, it becomes nearly vertical. So that the ovary is usually described as having an upper pole and lower pole. So see, this is the first figure where the vertical axis is there. So ovaries are having upper pole and lower pole. But in multiparous women, which are, that means the woman who given birth to the children, so here the long axis becomes horizontal so that the upper pole points laterally and the lower pole points medially. So the ovary, it is going to change its direction. So whatever the vertical ovaries are there, that becomes horizontal. And afterwards, this upper pole goes laterally and lower pole comes to medially. So see, this is the figure. That means this is the figure. In the first figure, this is the nulliparous woman where the ovaries are vertical so that it's having upper pole and lower pole. Second figure, the ovaries becomes horizontal so that upper pole comes laterally, lower pole goes medially. Why this is happening means due to the pull of pregnant uterus. In multiparous woman means they are giving birth to children. So at the time of pregnancy, the uterus is going to enlarge enormously with heavy fetus. And due to that heavy weight of uterus, due to pull of uterus, the vertical ovaries become horizontal. So this is very much important. In young girls, before the onset of ovulation, the ovaries have a smooth surfaces which are grayish pink in color. Before the onset of ovulation, you remember that in young girls, the ovaries, they are having smooth surface and these are grayish pink in color. But after puberty, once the ovulation starts, the surface becomes uneven because after each and every menses, either from left or from right, this single ovum, it is come, just means this dispatch from the ovary or coming out from the ovary. At that time, the ovaries are going, ovary is going to rupture, and this phenomena is known as ovulation. So due to ovulation, scar will be there, and this scar again going to repair by fibrous tissue, so that its net result is that surface becomes uneven and the color changes from grayish pink to gray in color. Each ovary has two poles or extremities, the upper or tuber pole and the lower or uterine pole. Two borders, anterior or mesovarian border and the posterior or free border. Two surfaces, lateral and medial surface. Relations for the ovaries are peritoneal relations and visceral relations. The ovary is almost entirely covered with peritoneum. This is very much important, except along the mesovarian or anterior border, where the two layers of covering peritoneum are reflected. The two layers, they are attached there and they are reflected onto the posterior layer of the broad ligament of the uterus. Here, these are the two fallopian, that means these ovaries are there. And it's present in the broad ligament. See, anterior and posterior layers of broad ligament, this figure is there. Ovarian artery, here anterior border, that is known as mesovarian border. Next, visceral relations, upper or tuber pole. It is broader than the lower pole and is related to the uterine tube and the external iliac vein. It is broader, upper pole is broader and it is than the lower pole, and it's related to the uterine tube, that is fallopian tube, and to the external iliac vein. The right ovary may be related to the appendix if the latter is pelvic in position. Means its meaning is the right ovary sometimes may be related to the appendix. Here near the ovary, appendix is there when it is in the pelvic condition. Keep in your mind, not always appendix is related. Whenever it is in pelvic condition, appendix is having lot of conditions. You are knowing pre-ileal, post-ileal, para-ileal, as well as nothing but here, this 3 o'clock position is there, and this nothing but here, pelvic position is there. You are knowing retrosecal position, that is 2 o'clock position. It is commonest position of the appendix. And 60%, that means people, they are having that position retrosecal behind the cecum. But here, second 30% people, they are having this second commonest position, which is known as pelvic position, which is 4 o'clock position. And this 4 o'clock position means the appendix, it is directed towards the pelvis. That's why it is known as pelvic condition. So if appendix is pelvic condition, and here in this condition, the ovaries are related to the appendix, it's having clinical importance. So in such type of condition, there will be pain there. The ovarian fimbria and the suspensory ligament of the ovary are attached to the upper pole of the ovary. Ovarian fimbria, I told you, fimbriated end yesterday. One fimbria is larger, that is known as ovarian fimbria. And when the ovary ruptured, so at that time, this ovarian fimbria captures the ovum and sends it to the infundibulum and then enters through the fallopian tube. As well as suspensory ligament, which is pelvic condensation, pelvic fascia condensation, which attaches the ovary to the lateral pelvic wall. So these are suspensory ligaments. These are attached to the upper pole of ovary. Next here, that means nothing but here, this lower or uterine pole, it is narrower than the upper pole and is related to pelvic floor. It's connected by the ligament of ovary carefully just below the fallopian tube. This lateral angle of the uterus gives attachment to ligament of ovary. It is connected by the ligament of the ovary to the lateral angle of uterus posterior-inferior to the attachment of fallopian tube. The ligament lies between the two layers of broad ligament of the uterus and contains smooth muscle fibers. Anterior or mesovarian border. It is straight and related to the uterine tube or fallopian tube and is obliterated umbilical artery. It's attached to the back of broad ligament of uterus by mesovarium and forms the hilus of the ovary. Posterior border, it is convex and is related to the uterine tube and ureter. So, ovaries, they are nothing but the female gonads which are going to form female gametes, and these are nothing but in nulliparous woman, they are vertical, containing upper pole and lower pole. In multiparous woman, they are nothing but horizontal, and upper pole goes laterally and lower pole comes medially due to pull of pregnant uterus. Afterwards, they are containing upper pole, which is broader and comes in relation with uterine tube. Lower pole comes in relation with pelvic floor, which is narrower than the upper pole. Upper pole, which is gives attachment to suspensory ligament. Lower pole gives attachment to the nothing but ovarian ligament. Anterior border to which peritoneum is attached, that is known as mesovarian border. Meso means peritoneum. Two layers are attached and afterwards they are going to reflect, and it is attached to the broad ligament of uterus. Posterior or free border, which is related to the uterine tube. Very important thing is there. Lateral surface, it is related to ovarian fossa, which is lined by parietal peritoneum. You are knowing peritoneum, it is a serous membrane which is having outermost parietal peritoneum, innermost visceral layer, outermost parietal layer. This peritoneum separates the ovary from the obturator vessels and nerves. Medial surface, it is largely covered by uterine tube, and the peritoneal recess between the mesosulfinx and this surface is known as ovarian bursa. In short, you are remember, these ovaries, they are just like unshelled almond size ovaries are there. They are oval shaped and they are present in ovarian fossa. They are having upper pole, lower pole, anterior border, posterior border, medial surface and lateral surface. These are the arterial supply. Arterial supply, the ovarian artery, which gives arterial supply, as well as uterine artery. Ovarian artery, here see this right side there is, and this is uterine artery. The both, they are giving blood supply to the ovaries. Venous drainage, veins emerge at the hilus and form a pampiniform venous plexus. Before these things, I will just tell you, before arterial supply, you see the lateral surface and medial surface. Afterwards, we will go to see this nothing but ligaments of ovary. So see carefully here, these ligaments are there. So first one is mesovarian. I told you mesovarian, the broad ligament of the uterus, which itself a part of parietal peritoneum. It attaches to the ovaries by a double layer fold of peritoneum called as mesovarian. Ovarian ligament, it anchors the ovaries to the uterus. That uterus attached to the ovary, that ligament is known as ovarian ligament. Third ligament is known as suspensory ligament. It attaches the ovaries to the pelvic wall. So just upper word before that I shown you the suspensory ligament, it is there along with that. In this figure also you can see this suspensory ligament, and below this ligament of ovary, third one is mesovarian. So ovary contains three types of ligament: mesovarian, that is peritoneal, ovarian ligament, and next is suspensory ligament. Ovarian ligament, it is made up of smooth muscle. Suspensory ligament, it is the condensation of pelvic fascia. Mesovarian, it is the fold of parietal peritoneum. Each ovary contains hilus, and the point hilus is the point of entrance for blood vessels and here nerves, and along which the mesovarian is attached. So ovaries, they are having entrance point that is known as hilus. Arterial supply: ovarian artery, uterine artery, veins, pampiniform venous plexus, lymphatic drainage, lateral aortic and pre-aortic lymph nodes. Nerve supply: ovarian nervous plexus derived from renal, aortic and hypogastric plexuses accompanies the ovarian artery. It contains both sympathetic and parasympathetic nerves. Sympathetic nerves derived from T10 to T12. T10 and T12 sympathetic, spinal segment. These are afferent for pain as well as efferent or vasomotor. Parasympathetic nerves, they are derived from S2, S3, S4 spinal nerves, and these are vasodilator in nature. Functions are production of oocytes and production of hormones. So here next is most important thing here, that is histology. Histology, you should see that. That means histologically, each ovary consists following parts. Number one, see outermost layer, it is known as nothing but germinal epithelium. So germinal epithelium, it is a layer, simple epithelium of cubicle cells that covers the surface of ovary. So outermost layer of ovary, that is known as germinal epithelium, and it is a layer which is made up of simple epithelium of cubicle cells. So here it is formed by cubicle cells that covers the surface of ovary. It is continuous with mesothelium that covers the mesovarian. It is derived from peritoneum. Second one is tunica albuginea. Below the outermost layer, tunica albuginea, it is a capsule of dense irregular connective tissue immediately deep to the germinal epithelium. Just next is stroma, a region of connective tissue, tissue deep to the tunica albuginea and composed of an outer dense layer called cortex and an inner loose layer known as medulla. The cortex contains follicles. All the follicles you are seeing, that is known as cortex. So the cortex here, different follicles are ovarian follicles. It contains different types of follicles. So first one here, see carefully, primordial follicles, most immature, that means primary follicles, then developing follicles. In this way, it contains different types of ovarian follicles, oocytes, immature ova and their surrounding epithelial tissue in various stages of development. So cortex, it contains different types of follicles which are in the different stages of development. It also contains vesicular ovarian follicle, or it is known as Graafian follicle. See in the figure, there is mature Graafian follicle is there. If you are first year students, you keep in your mind, the Graafian follicle, it is coming for short question. A large fluid filled cavity, that means structure, containing an immature ovum and it is surrounding epithelial tissue. The follicle here, see the Graafian follicle, it is large in nature. It is contain a cavity which contains fluid and it contains immature ovum. It see carefully, there is secondary ovum is there, and it is covered by epithelial tissue, and the follicle secretes hormones that are called estrogens. So this one is Graafian follicle. In the histology, you should write all these things. At the time of 14th day, 14 to 16 day, that is the day of ovulation. So at the time, if this ovary going to rupture, and the Graafian, that means the ovary, wall of ovary going to rupture, Graafian follicle going to rupture, and the secondary ovum, it comes out, it is liberated. See carefully in the figure, they shown ruptured follicle and liberated ovum. After liberation of the ovum, this ruptured follicle, it is going to convert into corpus luteum, a mature vesicular ovarian follicle that has ruptured to expel a secondary oocyte, that is potential mature ovum, and the process is called as ovulation. It produces the hormones progesterone, estrogen, relaxin and inhibin until it degenerates and turns into fibrous tissue called corpus albicans. So see carefully, Graafian follicle, it is a large follicle, contains fluid filled cavity plus secondary ovum and surrounded by epithelial tissue. At the time of ovulation, or at this 14 to 60 days of menstrual period, ovulation period, that means the Graafian follicle get ruptured and the ovum, secondary ovum get liberated. And once the ovum comes out, this Graafian follicle next converted into corpus luteum. This is also known as yellow body. And this corpus luteum, it's very much important because it secretes progesterone, estrogen in little amount, relaxin and inhibin. So mainly its secretion is progesterone. You keep in your mind, this progesterone, simultaneously it is working on the endometrium. So it increases the thickness of endometrium. It increases the secretory phenomena or secretory function of the glands, and it makes the gland more enlarged, and they are going to more secrete the uterine milk, so that the whole endometrium, it comes in, yesterday I explained, that is in the secretory phase. And just nearby end of that, that means the secretory phase, if there is, that means fertilization occurs, then the lifespan of corpus luteum, it is going to increase. And corpus luteum, it continues its secretion of the progesterone for the continuation of pregnancy until the formation of placenta. Placenta is going to form at the third month of pregnancy, and up to that, the maintenance of pregnancy, it is that means it's carried out with the help of corpus luteum by the secretion of progesterone. Once placenta occurs or placenta forms, the corpus luteum degenerates and it becomes white body, that is known as corpus albicans. But here in general menstrual cycle, after rupture of Graafian follicle, the ovum liberates it, that means converted into corpus luteum. It continues secretion progesterone. It forms the secretory phase of endometrium. It forms petal bed for incoming embryo. But if this menstrual, that means if the fertilization does not occur at that time, suddenly there is decline or decrease in the percentage or decrease in this, that means the level of estrogen and progesterone, and that trigger for the menstruation. And afterwards, corpus luteum shrinks and it becomes a fibrous white body, that is known as corpus albicans. So these are all these parts which are, we have to explain in the histology of the ovary. So histology, it contains germinal epithelium, that is the outermost layer, which is formed by cubical cells that are derived from peritoneum. Just below this, tunica albuginea, which is dense connective tissue. Below this, stroma is there. It is a region of connective tissue which contains outermost cortex and med. That means middle one, which is a loose layer, that is central one, that is known as medulla. Cortex contains different developmental stages of ovarian follicles. In that, see carefully, primordial follicle, primary follicle, as well as developing follicles. Then Graafian follicle, after rupture of Graafian follicle, corpus luteum and corpus albicans. These all the things you have to remember. If the Oris, generally they are coming for 5 marks. So if Oris are coming for 5 marks, external features are less. So you have to write all this internal, that means this histology, which is very much important. So here you should remember all the things. Otherwise it will be difficult, because marks, getting marks, it will be difficult. So that you should write neatly all the things. In clinical anatomy, we should read, we should see that, that means the determination of ovulation. In cases of sterility, the ovulation can be determined by the different method. And nowadays, before, in the previous that means textbook, they were giving different methods, just like basal body temperature, then cervical mucus test, premenstrual vaginal smear, and premenstrual endometrial biopsy. But nowadays, due to advanced technology, directly scanning came. So that they are doing repeated, that means sonography, and by that they can see directly follicular study. So follicles are going to form, our graafian follicle ruptured or not, ovum released or not. These all the things, if we are going to see by naked eye, then there is no need of such type of indirect methods. That's why don't keep in your mind directly. Nowadays they are telling that in cases of sterility, the ovulation can be determined by that is directly by the repeated ultrasounds. Repeated ultrasounds are very much important. In between that ovulation period, 4-5 days or 1 week nearby, daily they are doing the scanning or sonography, by which they can come to know graafian follicle is formed, it has going to rupture or not. If going to rupture, then corpus luteum form or not. So all these things are there. Another one test is there, that is known as premenstrual endometrial biopsy. It shows progesterone phase of endometrium, which is very much important. This is also carried out in the nursing home, because along with sonography also, this is also very much important. Before menses, they are calling that patient and they are taking the piece of endometrium by the method that is known as D&C, dilatation and curettage. And this piece of endometrium they are giving for histopathological study, in which they are going to see whether the endometrium is in secretory phase or proliferative phase. If it is in proliferative phase, it is called as negative result, because there is no chances or no signs of ovulation. If the endometrium is in secretory phase, then it is the positive sign, because ovulation is going on properly. So for in sterility cases, for male, mainly semen test is there. And in female, yesterday I told you tubal patency, and next mainly ovulation, secondly tubal patency. These two things are very much important. So here, determination of ovulation. Ovum is the main important primary organ is there. So that determination of ovulation is very much important. Prolapse of ovaries. Ovaries are frequently displaced to the pouch of Douglas, where they can be palpated by upper vaginum exam. I told you very important it is there, because ovaries, they are, if they are displaced, I told you suspensory ligament is there, ovarian ligament is there. So these ligaments, if they are holding properly the ovary in proper position in the ovarian fossa, but if they are going to lose, and yesterday I told you similarly, just like in uterus, and uterus, why these ligaments are going to lose? Because of recurrent deliveries, continuous. If we are telling that 3 years gap should be there in between two children, because within 3 years that uterus and ligaments and surrounding all the structures, they will come to normal stage. But if it is not coming, and if there is very less gap is in between two children, so continuous deliveries, due to that there will be pressure on this nothing but surrounding all the supports of uterus, and they become loose, and the uterus is going to sag inside the ovary. That is known as prolapse. Similarly, the ovaries also, their ligaments going to weak, and ovaries they displace, or due to some injury, there will be injury to the ovaries, and ovaries they are going to sag inside the pouch of Douglas. I told you pouch of Douglas, which is nothing but peritoneal pouch which is present in between rectum and uterus, that is rectouterine pouch. And yesterday I told you, do you remember, it is the, that means deepest, that may pay place in the pelvic region. So as per the gravitational force, if ovaries are displaced from the place, okay, that means as usual, obviously they are coming and lie in the pouch of Douglas. And in per vaginum exam, we can just, that means insert our finger in the vagina at that time, we can just palpate the ovaries in the pouch of Douglas. Ovarian cyst, next is ovarian cyst. The developmental arrest of the ovarian follicles may result in the formation of one or more small ovarian cysts. The corpus luteum of pregnancy can form a very large cyst, corpus luteum in pregnancy. If there is formation of cyst is there, that will be going to form a large cyst, huge cyst. In my life, I seen such type of two cysts. When I was doing PG at that time, one case came in our Shalya department. That lady, she was having 45 kg, one huge ovarian cyst. Another one, when I was working near one surgeon, I seen such type of case. That lady was 65, 70 years age, old lady. She was having nearby 30 to 35 kg ovarian cyst. So very huge ovarian cyst, these two I seen in my life. Sometimes developmental arrest of the ovarian follicles may result in the formation of more small ovarian cysts, and that is known as, nowadays it is a very burning issue is there, which is known as PCOD or PCOS. So polycystic ovarian syndrome, that's a very common nowadays in young children or young girls. And due to our lifestyle disorders and all the things, otherwise another one is there, whatever we are eating, pesticides and all, we are taking milk which is already, they are giving more hormones to the animals, so that all the adulterated we are eating, and that's why this is a burning issue is there, PCOS or PCOD. Here the signs are there, that is heavy menstruation or scanty menstruation, irregular menstruation, obesity or growth of hairs, acne, these are all the clinical symptoms of the PCOS. Next is carcinoma of ovary. It is common and accounts for 15% of all cancers and 20% of gynecological cancer. Another one thing is there, that is when you are studying the breast, that is the, that means mammary glands. So the carcinoma of breast, the malignant tissues or malignant cells of breast, they are going to just carry or they are going to transfer toward the liver, and it may cause secondaries in the liver. From the liver, the malignant tissue, they fall in pelvis, and again secondaries are going to form in the ovary. So in such type of cases, carcinoma of ovary is there, but original site is the breast. Ovaries are the commonest site in the abdomen for endometriosis. Endometriosis means, you are knowing, that is endometrium, it is the innermost layer of the nothing but uterus. It should normally present in the uterus, but sometimes abnormally the piece of this tissue may present in some another abdominal organs, such type ovaries, fallopian tubes or intestines. In this, ovaries are the commonest site in the, that means for the endometriosis, it needs medicinal correction as well as surgical correction also. So these are all nothing but this, that means the whole things are there that are related to ovaries. Next we will going to see the part, that is vagina. Vagina, the synonyms are colpus, from which the colposcopy, colporaphy, this colpotomy. Colposcopy means to visualize the vagina. Colporaphy, that is the repairing of vagina. And that means next is there, that is colpotomy, that is the excision of this vagina. So to open, not excision, sorry. This is opening of the vagina. So these are all the structures which are present in this nothing but here, in the that means in this vagina. So first one, the colposcopy or this vagina or colpus, that is nothing but here, this is the main part, or this is the nothing but this synonym of the vagina. The vagina is a fibromuscular canal forming the female copulatory organ. For sexual intercourse, this is the copulation, or means sexual intercourse. So it is the organ of copulation in female. Organ of copulation in male, that is penis. The term vagina means a sheath. It is just like a sheath. Extent and situation. The vagina extends from the vulva to the uterus and is situated behind the bladder and the urethra and in front of the rectum and the anal canal. So vagina, it is a sheath and it extends from vulva to the uterus. Vulva means external genital organs. From uterus to the external genital organs, it is present and it is situated anteriorly bladder and urethra, posteriorly rectum and anal canal. Direction in the erect posture, the vagina is directed upwards and backwards. Size and shape, the anterior wall of vagina is about 8 cm long and see carefully, posterior wall is long, which is 10 cm. The diameter of vagina is gradually increases from below upwards. See carefully, the upper part, it is 5 cm. That is the twice of the lower part. Lower part is 2.5 cm wide. Upper part is 5 cm wide. However, it is quite distensible and allows the passage of head of fetus during delivery. At the time of vaginal delivery, the head of fetus passing through this vaginal, that means canal, and which is quietly distensible. Because the head also distensible, fetal head, the fetal skull bones are there, they are very smooth. And here the sutures also not that much, that means thick in nature. So they are these, that means the fetal skull bones, they are overlapping with each other to reduce the size of this head of the fetus. And the vagina also, it is distensible and it allows the passage of head of fetus during delivery. The lumen is circular at the upper end because of the protrusion of cervix into it. See carefully, this is the cervix and just lowermost is vagina. Below the cervix, the anterior and posterior walls are come in contact with each other so that the lumen is a transverse slit in middle part and a H shape in the lower part. So these two, that means anterior as well as posterior walls, they are come in contact with each other and it is H shape. So see carefully, uterine cavity and cervix is there and lowermost, that whole the sheath-like structure, that is known as vagina. Here, these are nothing but if we are taking section, in lower one-third, it is S-shape. In middle one-third, semicircular. Upper one-third, circular are there. So fornices, see carefully, here this vagina, it is the nothing but protruded inside this, the cervical part protruded inside the vagina and forms fornices. Anterior fornix, posterior fornix, and two lateral fornices. Relations are anterior wall, upper half is related to base of bladder, lower half is related to urethra. Posterior wall, very easy to remember, upper one-fourth is separated from the rectum by rectouterine pouch, middle two-fourth separated from the rectum by loose areolar tissue, lower one-fourth is separated from the anal canal by perineal body and muscles attached to it. I told you 10 muscles they are inserted. So this is nothing but vagina is there. Lateral on each side, the upper one is related to the transverse cervical ligament of pelvic fissure in which are embedded a network of vaginal veins and the ureter crossed by the uterine artery. The middle one third is related to the pubococcygeus part of levator ani and lower one third pierces the urogenital diaphragm below which it is related to bulb of vestibule, bulbospongiosus, and greater vestibular gland of Bartholin. So this is the picture of vagina. See carefully, upper half part of this cervix, it is protruded, and whatever the angles are there, that are known as fornices. And here it is pierces, see there is, this is the line is there, that is urogenital diaphragm pierces, and then it merges with, see carefully here, it is related to, this one is bulb of vestibule and this is greater vestibular. that means gland of bulb, that means Bartholin. Bartholin is the name of scientist. So this is nothing but the relations. Arterial supply, vagina, it is having vascular. That means more vascular main artery supplying. It is the vaginal branch of internal iliac artery. Additional to this, it is supplied by upper part is supplied by cervico-vaginal branch of uterine artery. Lower part is supplied by middle rectal and internal pudendal arteries. Venous drainage, the rich vaginal venous plexus drains into interior iliac veins through the vaginal veins which accompany the vaginal artery. So vaginal plexus drains into internal iliac vein. If you are not remembering, directly write down internal iliac veins. That means venous drainage. Lymphatic drainage divided into three parts. Upper one-third drains into external iliac lymph nodes. Middle one-third which is going to drain into internal iliac lymph nodes. And lower one-third, it is going to drain into medial group of, just write down, superficial inguinal lymph nodes. Nerve supply, the lower one-third of vagina is pain sensitive and is supplied by pudendal nerve. You are knowing pudendal nerve, it is a somatic nerve. The upper two-thirds of the vagina are pain insensitive, supplied by sympathetic L1, L2, parasympathetic segments S2, S3. That's why at the time of delivery, whenever we are giving episiotomy, we have to give, that means we have to block the pudendal artery by giving local anesthesia xylocaine, and then only we have to go for episiotomy, because lower one-third of vagina, it is pain sensitive. Somatic nerves are always pain sensitive. Autonomic nerves, that is sympathetic and parasympathetic, they are always pain insensitive. Histology, mucous membrane is lined by non-keratinized stratified squamous epithelium. Lamina propria is made up of loose connective tissue. Muscular coat, which consists outer longitudinal and inner circular layer. The outer fibrous coat is the usual connective tissue. So these are all nothing but this general explanation of this vagina. Here, clinical anatomy, vaginal examination. First one, it's a very much important in gynecological condition. So vaginal examination, which contains number one, inspection. Inspection we have to do, that means by separating the labia minora, either by finger or by speculum, to inspect cervix and vaginal wall. Palpation per vaginal digital exam. So in this, we have to insert the two fingers or one finger or mostly two fingers in the vagina of the patient, and we have to palpate the structures. When the physician or the gynecologist inserting the two fingers, he or she may palpate the following structure: anteriorly urethra, bladder, pubic symphysis; posteriorly rectum, pouch of Douglas; laterally ovary, tube, lateral pelvic wall; superiorly cervix. Bimanual exam means here this exam to assess the size and position of the uterus. Means the examiner should, that means the physician or the examiner should pass or to introduce the two fingers, insert two fingers in the vagina of the right hand, and left hand of the examiner should be kept on the lower abdomen of the patient. And in this way, we can assess the size of uterus, enlargements of ovaries and tubes and other pelvic masses. Any pelvic masses are there, we can palpate easily with the help of bimanual exam. Nowadays, sonography came, that's why not much more this type of this exams are there. Otherwise, previously, for assessing pregnancy also, this exam was routinely carried out. But nowadays, in first trimester, means in first 3 months of pregnancy, no one is doing such type of PV exam, because it is going to disturb the embryo implantation. Because embryo is implanted and it is not that much firm there. Firm attachment is not there, or firm implantation is not there. First 3 months, it is not that much stable. And in the bimanual exam, there may be chances of, that means this implantation should go into disturb, or this embryo from its place, that is posterior wall of fundus, may get to disturb, and there may be chances of abortion. So nowadays, nobody is going to do it the first trimester. They are directly going for sonography, and by that only they are assessing the pregnancy. It's a very easy method. Next is vaginal laceration. That is, traumatic lacerations of vagina are very common and may be caused by forcible coits or forcible intercourse, otherwise during childbirth or by accident. If there is, that means obstructed labor is there, or if at the time of labor, if they are using forceps or any one instruments, there may be chances of lacerations of vagina. This may give rise to profuse bleeding. It may give rise to profuse bleeding because I told you it is also highly vascular organ. And hymen is examined in medico-legal cases to confirm virginity of that patient. Vaginitis, it is a common before puberty and after menopause because of thin, delicate epithelium. Itis means inflammation. Inflammation of vagina, it is known as vaginitis, which is very much common in the puberty as well as in menopause, because in these two conditions there is thin, delicate epithelium is there. In adults, the resistant squamous epithelium prevents the infection. Vaginitis is commonly caused by trichomonal infection, monilial infection, or gonococcal infection. It causes leucorrhea, or which is also known as white discharge. Prolapse of the anterior wall of vagina drags the bladder. It takes along with it bladder downwards. That is known as cystocele. Cysto means bladder, cystocele. It also drags urethra, that is known as urethrocele. Or posterior wall prolapse, it drags the rectum, that is known as rectocele. Then neoplasm, this is nothing but here, neoplasm, that is the mostly the case of this carcinomatous tissues or carcinomatous growth or tumor formation, that is known as neoplasm. And trauma to the anterior and posterior wall of vagina can cause vesicovaginal, urethrovaginal and rectovaginal fistula. This is also very dangerous condition. See carefully vagina, urethra, as well as this rectum. These all are very close with each other. Vagina is in between posteriorly rectum, anteriorly the lower base of bladder, and urethra is there. So you should remember that by surgical or by any surgical procedure or obstructed labor or forceps delivery, if there is injury to this vagina and bladder, it may cause vesico-vaginal fistula. Fistula means track in between these two structures. Urethrovaginal fistula means track in between urethra and vagina. Rectovaginal fistula means track in between or connection in between, that is rectum as well as vagina. This track or this fistula, it is a very minute, it is just like hairline, just like the thickness of hair, that much small, very minute fistula is there, but it's a very dangerous in vesicovaginal and in urethrovaginal fistula. There is continuous dribbling of urine through vagina is going to occur. If rectovaginal fistula is there, there is continuous dribbling of nothing but this fecal material occurs. I told you neoplasm, that is primary new growth which is present in the vagina, and it is maybe next converted into nothing but carcinomatous. Though they are sometimes benign tumors or growths are there, maybe chances are converts into carcinoma. Colpotomy means to open the vagina, colporaphy to repair the vaginal wall, and here another one word is coming, that is episiotomy. In primary or in first pregnancy, at the time of delivery, the vaginal wall and all these are very, and the birth canal, it is very tight. So it is an incision, episiotomy, given in the posterior lateral side of vagina to increase the size of outlet for baby during delivery. So in the clinical application in the vagina, it is very much important. First, you keep in your mind vaginal examinations. Second, vaginal lacerations. Third one, vaginitis. Fourth, prolapse. Fifth, neoplasm. And last is colpotomy or colporaphy. So these are all these nothing but conditions which are nothing but applied to the vagina. Last chapter from the female reproductive system, that is known as, that means external genital organs of female, which are also known as pudendum or vulva. Any one word will come for exam. It may be come for short question or generally coming for 5 marks. So you should keep in your mind, this nothing but external genital organs, which includes mons pubis, labia majora, labia minora, clitoris, vestibule of the vagina, bulb of vestibule, and greater vestibular glands. So first one, see carefully, mons pubis. So mons pubis, it is a rounded eminence present in front of pubic symphysis. You are knowing pubic symphysis, the symphysial surface of two pubis attach with each other or articulates with each other to form pubic symphysis. And this pubic symphysis, it is covered by fatty pad of tissue, and that is covered by abundant, that means hair. It is formed by accumulation of subcutaneous fat, and it is covered with pubic hair. The hair bearing area has a nearly horizontal upper limit. And this mons pubis, its functions are, at the time of sexual intercourse, it prevents the pubic symphysis from fracture. So that means by weight bearing, there may be chances of injury to the pubic symphysis. Due to this fatty pad, the pubic symphysis is going to nothing but here protect. Labia majora. Next is here labium majus, singular. Labia majora, that is double or plural. These are two thick folds of skin enclosing fat. They form the lateral boundaries of pudendal cleft. Their outer surfaces are covered with hair, and the inner surfaces are studded with large sebaceous glands. The larger anterior ends are connected to each other below the mons pubis to form the anterior commissure. There is anterior commissure is there. And here, that means this, the skin connecting the less prominent posterior edges of labia is known as posterior commissure. The area between the posterior commissure and the anus, which is about 2.5, see carefully here, there is nothing but here, just at the posterior end of labia majora and anus, that distance is 2.5 centimeter long, constitutes the gynecological perineum, which is having very much importance in the gynecology. Labia minora, see singular is labium minus. These are two thin folds of skin which lie within the pudendal cleft. Anteriorly, each labium minus splits into two layers. The upper layer joined the corresponding layer of opposite side to form the prepuce of clitoris. And here, this is similarly, the lower layers of two folds joins to form the frenulum of clitoris. Posteriorly, the two labia minora meet to form the frenulum of labia minora. Just remember that outermost large folds, they are known as labia majora. Innermost small folds, they are known as labia minora. The inner surface of labia minora contains numerous sebaceous glands. So labia majora, also inner surfaces, they are contains sebaceous glands, and labia minora also contains sebaceous glands. Next is clitoris. The clitoris, it is an erectile organ and homologous with the penis. In male, penis is there. In female, that is nothing but clitoris is there. However, it is not traversed by urethra. This one is very much important. In male, both the passages, that is passage for urine and passage for semen, both are same, that is urethra. But in female, urethral orifice is different and vaginal orifice is different. So this clitoris does not traverse by urethra. It lies in the anterior part of pudendal cleft, and the body of clitoris is made up of two corpora cavernosa enclosed in fibrous sheath. Corpus spongiosum is absent here. In clitoris, corpus spongiosum is absent. It is formed by two corpora cavernosa. These are nothing but spongy erectile tissues. You had seen in the male reproductive system, three parallel tissues are there. In that two parallel, they are known as corpora cavernosa. And just along with this, corpus spongiosum is there. And corpus spongiosum, it is traversed by urethra. In the male, but in female this carpus spongiosum is absent, so that there is no question, and that's why this clitoris in the female, it does not, that means having traverse with the thing but the urethra. The surface of glands, the surface of this clitoris, it is highly sensitive, and the surface, it is known as having one rounded tubercle, that is known as glands, that means clitoridis. And the surface of glands, it is highly sensitive, it is having highly nerve supply and plays an important role in the sexual responses. Next is, that is next part is there, which is known as vestibule of the vagina. So vestibule, it is the space which is present in between two labia minora. The structures which are present here, first one, see carefully, urethral, that means opening. See, urethral meatus or opening or urethral orifice, it lies about 2.5 centimeter behind the clitoris, just in front of vaginal orifice. It is the opening of urethra. Next is large, you are seeing irregular, that is vaginal orifice, or introitus, it lies in the posterior part of vestibule, and see carefully, very important, it is partly closed in the virgin before marriage or before first sexual intercourse. This is partially covered by one thin membrane structure that is known as hymen, and by a thin membrane that is called as hymen. In married woman, after first sexual intercourse, the hymen gets ruptured, and afterward it is represented by rounded tacts of tissues called as that means carunculae hymenalis. So this is hymen, which plays an important role in medico-legal cases. Next is orifices of greater, here orifices of greater vestibular glands. So greater vestibular glands also, they are present, orifices are there. They lie on each side of vaginal orifice between the hymen and labium minus. Numerous lesser vestibular or mucous glands open on the surface of vestibule. The posterior part of vestibule between vaginal orifice and the labia minora forms a small depression, shallow depression, known as vestibular. In short, in the vestibule, just remember, vestibule, it is the place in between the two labia minora. It contains urethral orifice, vaginal orifice, orifices of ducts of greater vestibular gland, and orifices of, that means numerous lesser vestibular glands. Then here next is coming, that is, that these are there. Along with that, you should remember these greater vestibular glands are very much important. These are the glands which are homologous with bulbourethral glands or Cooper in the male. You must remember the bulbourethral glands, they secrete the secretion which is also a part of semen. And these bulbourethral glands here, can you see this in the figure? This greater vestibular glands are there, and here next is there in the urogenital diaphragm only. Bulbourethral glands are there, which are secreting mucus type of secretion in male also, in female also. So their main function is there. They are lubricating the external genital organs as well as the vaginal orifice also. In male, they are lubricating the glans penis and tip of penis. In female, they are lubricating the external genital organs, and that is most important for lubrication, that is easy sexual intercourse. So these lie in the superficial perineal space. Each gland has a long duct about 2 centimeter long, which opens at the side of the hymen, between the hymen and the labium minus. So greater vestibular glands, these are the glands of Cooper, or these are also known as, they are homologous with the bulbourethral glands of Cooper in the male, because these are most important for lubrication. So the space of perineum in the female, it is occupied by external genital organs, which contains mons pubis, labia majora, labia minora, vestibule. These are the most important, all the structures are there. Mons pubis, labia majora, labia minora, clitoris homologous with penis, vestibule of vagina, that is the space, bulb of vestibule is there, and next is greater vestibular glands. So bulb of vestibule, these are the two oval bodies of erectile tissue that correspond to the two half portions of bulb of penis. The bulbs lie on either side of vaginal and urethral orifices. So here in this figure it is there, this bulb of vestibule, these are two bulbs are there, which are bulb of nothing but this penis, which is the homologous with the bulb of penis. So these are all structures are there which are present in the external genital organs. In the clinical anatomy, you should remember the Mons pubis, it is studded with hairs, so it is the common site for fungal infection also. As well as in the vaginal opening, you should remember that the vaginal opening partially in the virgin condition, it is partially covered by hymen. I told you at the first sexual intercourse, it is partially get ruptured, and that is the main, that means the hymen condition of hymen is which plays an important role in medico-legal cases. So lot of this Cooper's gland and all cyst may be present. So these are all the clinical applications which are present in this, and this vaginal orifice may get injured and all. So here all these are nothing but clinical applications you should remember. So today we had seen all these things. First see this, we had seen the ovaries, its conditions, whatever its location, its upper pole, lower pole, anterior border, posterior border, medial surface, lateral surface, as well as the here arterial supply. Next is functions, formation of oocyte and production of hormones, histology in detail, clinical anatomy, then vagina, all the structures here, fornices. See carefully, fornices are there. The vaginal canal, it protrudes, and due to that the upper circular part which forms the spaces that are known as fornices. Yesterday I told you the fornices are very much important because generally the semen, it is at the time of sexual intercourse, it get deposits in posterior wall, that is in posterior fornix, because I told you posterior wall of vagina, it is 10 cm long, so that semen may be placed there more time, for more time it will be there, and then it is slowly enter through this nothing but external os, then it goes to internal os of uterus, and afterwards it is enter in the fallopian tube for fertilization. Sometimes in retroverted uterus, otherwise if it is going to deposit in anterior fornix, soon after the sexual intercourse the semen may come out. In our Ayurveda it is called as vamini yoni vapan. So that whole this vagina is doing just like vomiting, so that it comes out and there will be no chances of the fertilization. So these are all the things are there, anterior wall, posterior wall, everything. This anatomy is very much important, things are there, we have to learn in detail, most important is there. So all the things I told you, female external genital organs, all these Mons pubis, labia majora, labia minora, due to sebaceous glands, they are also the common site for infections, as well as clitoris, vestibule of vagina, bulbs of vestibule and greater vestibular glands. The cyst of this Bartholin cyst, it is also common, greater vestibular gland, it is known as Bartholin's gland. So cyst of Bartholin gland also, it is commonly present. So yesterday I explained you uterus and fallopian tubes. Today I explained you ovaries, vagina and external genital organs. So all the structures I explained you. So please, if you are having any doubts, see carefully. This is again the prepuce, here clitoris, labia majus, labia minus, here perineal raphe, that means this gynecological perineum is there, urethral orifice and vaginal orifice. In this clitoris only all these things are there, that is the corpora cavernosa, it is forming, and here in the labia minora only I told you there are two, each labium minus splits into two layers, the upper layer joins the corresponding layer of opposite side, to form prepuce of clitoris. Similarly, the lower end, that means layers of two sides, joined to form frenulum of clitoris. So outermost two folds are known as labia majora, innermost they are known as labia minora. See there, clitoris glans is there, crest is there. Crest means which is attached to nothing but pubic symphysis, bulb of vestibule, and these large are their Bartholin's glands. External anatomy of vulva, this is internal anatomy of vulva. So this is total nothing but female reproductive system. Thank you very much. Just if you are having any doubts, you can ask me.
Platform is open for discussion. If there are any queries, further queries, you can directly ask ma'am, or else you can put that in the chat box. Ma'am, I think there are no queries.
Okay, no problem.
Yeah. One question. Okay. Ma'am, can you please explain the procedure of episiotomy?
Episiotomy procedure. That is
actually. I know that the question is not related to anatomy.
Yes.
Yeah, it should have been asked to in a prasuti seminar.
Okay, no problem.
Ma'am, you told about the Bartholin's glands. We also want to know about the skin's gland, ma'am.
This is the greater vestibular gland is there. There are some glands are there in the nothing but external pudendal gland. That means external pudendal or external genital organs. There are these greater glands are there, lesser glands are there, lot of glands are there. Out of these, large glands are there, known as greater vestibular gland. Same names are there. Vestibule means present in vestibule. Greater glands, their another name is Bartholin's glands. Is it clear? And if they are very small are there, that are known as lesser vestibular glands. So two types of glands are there. Larger glands are known as great, that means this figure I shown you, these are known as Bartholin glands. See here. These are greater vestibular, which are present in vestibules and large in size, and they are very prone to cyst, and smaller vestibular glands, and these both, they are numerous in number, and they are just going to open on the either side of urethral orifice as well as vaginal orifice. Is it clear? Episiotomy, see carefully, it is an incision in primi, or that means first time pregnancy when it is there, that lady is known as primi gravida. So in such type of patient, the vaginal, it is very stiff in nature, and if recurrent deliveries are going on, that structure is going to relax or lax. But first time it will be not there, so they are going to give more area for incoming the head of that baby. And if they are not giving to this episiotomy, means they are going to cut this posterolateral side of vagina. Just this is the, that means this vagina is there, I will show you. So in the vagina, they are giving the cut, and here, that means that cut first, before that they are going to block the that means nerve, pudendal nerve, and then patient is not feeling any pain by xylokin. And afterwards they are giving just like a V-shape on the either side, one side only, either left or right. That means when the head of that baby is bulging, when it is giving pressure on the vaginal wall and not coming out, if head is large or baby is heavy, in such type of condition, they are giving some space by cutting, and afterwards they have to lie down, they have to ligate, that means they have to stitch that episiotomy. And this is very much important in first, that means primary patient. Otherwise, there may be chances due to that hefty head, or due to that at the time of delivery, I showed you that gynecological perineum. So there may be chances of tear of perineum is there. And again, they have to stitch the perineum, and if stitching of perineum and continuous, that means nothing but healing of perineum, it will be difficult. And due to that cutting of peritoneum, there may be next in life of that lady, chances of prolapse are there. And generally we are seeing so many cases that prolapse, it may be occur in the home delivery patients. In home delivery, there is no chances of episiotomy and all. So there is perineal tear is going to occur, and there may be no, there is no ligation, no suturing is there. So this perineal tear, they are living as it is, and afterwards fibrous tissues, they are going to form, and the gap will be keeping as it is. And through that gap, rectocele may coming, cystocele may coming, or along with that, uterus may comes out. So this is episiotomy, that is the long procedure. After that, they are going to suture this innermost layer, mucus layer, as well as muscles, they are going to tie up. Levetiranae muscles are there, and after that, outermost skin, they are giving intraptate sutures. So episiotomy, though it is a small procedure, but I've seen so many infection cases also. After also, so many infections will come because nearby that anus is there, fecal material is there. So many chances of infections also there. So for normal delivery in primary patient, it is the must and should or compulsory procedure is there, episiotomy. Any another question?
Yeah, ma'am. One more question. Okay. Can you explain the urogenital diaphragm?
Urogenital diaphragm. Okay. Okay. That yesterday I told you, urogenital diaphragm. 1 minute. That is nothing but a partition, muscular partition actually. Mostly figure. 1 minute. In the supports of uterus, yesterday I told you, urogenital diaphragm, uterine axis, as well as all the ligaments, uterosacral, all the ligaments were there. So in that ligaments, these things are very much important. See carefully, this is pelvic diaphragm here. And urogenital diaphragm, that is also very small partition is there. That means pelvic diaphragm is very much important. And here urogenital diaphragm, it is double layer of pelvic fascia. It is a double layer of pelvic fascia. And here with its included muscles that is situated between ischial and pubic rami. In ischial rami is there, you are knowing in ischium, there is ischial tuberosity is there, body of ischium is there, ischial tuberosity is there, and ischial rami is there. Inferior ramus of pubis and ischial rami, they are forming ischiopubic rami. So whatever muscles are there in between ischial ramus and pubis ramus, that muscles, they are included. And this is the double layer of pelvic fascia. We should keep in your mind, most of the pelvic diaphragm or pelvic floor, it is formed by lot of muscles that are the muscles I read yesterday. That is the pelvic diaphragm and this perineal body muscles I told you. So along with that, I told you this perineal body, 10 muscles are there, and urogenital diaphragm, it is a double layer of pelvic fascia. Pelvic fascia plays an important role in this pelvic diaphragm. So this is nothing but urogenital diaphragm.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
Are there any further queries?
Ma'am, course of the ureter through abdomen and pelvis, and how the ureters are distinguished during this surgery, madam?
During this surgery? Yeah. Surgery, it's a very easy because uterus structure is very different. Very different. It's a very easy to just arteries, veins, nerves, ureters, all the things, and that makes that practice makes man perfect. Is it clear? So by that also, but ureters we can very easily identify. That is simple muscular tube is there, but we can visually very easily in that means see that. Lastly, we can see the attachment, but we can't go up to lumbar region, also up to kidney. But in that, we can follow the course of ureter and we can see the attachments and we can see the course, but we can very easily just that means see that things and we can identify. No problem for that. That's a very easy.
Okay. I think, ma'am, we can also diagnose it through the that ureteral peristalsis and the orbex flexes are also there.
Which one?
Only on the ureteral anterior surface.
Ureteral?
Orbex flexes, madam.
Huh.
Okay. Thank you.
Tell me once again. I can't listen properly. Huh?
Madam, I was talking about the ureteral peristalsis and also about
peristalsis. Okay.
Huh. Orbex flexes. Yeah.
Huh. And so no problem.
And the most sites of. Okay.
Huh? Common sites of?
Ureteral injuries, madam.
Injuries are that is depend upon the site of injury, but ureters they are mostly that means prone for the calculi. You are knowing there are constrictions are there at the just when they starts from pelvic ureteral junction is there. That is the main site is there where the constrictions of uterus you are knowing ureters. So constrictions are there, na? That are the main sites are there for the ureter, which are mainly pathological structures also. So that means pelvic ureteral junction is there, as well as when the ureter enters from greater pelvis to lesser pelvis, in the pelvic brim also it is going to constrict, and when it enters in the bladder, thickness of bladder, in the trigon it is entering, so there also nothing but constriction is there. That are the site, as well as it is very near crossed by uterine artery, so at the time of surgery or any abdominopelvic injuries, their chances are there for the ureters, that means injuries are there. That is depend upon the site and the extent or this seriousness of the injury. But for renal calculi, these are the sites, common sites are there, which are constrictions of the ureters.
Any further queries? Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
Can you give a summary on the ligamental supports of uterus, cervix, and vagina once more as a summary?
Summary. See carefully. In this, mainly for uterus, see these, all the figures are there. Perineal body where 10 muscles are going to insert. And you should keep in your mind that peritoneal supports, they are never giving support. They are the false ligaments. And they are the secondary supports. But primary supports are all these things. Pelvic diaphragm, I told you, which is mainly formed by levator ani muscle. Perineal body, where the 10 muscles are going to insert. So that if it is a very rounded, small body is there, if it is going to cut, there are chances of nothing but drag this uterus in the vagina. Urogenital diaphragm, I told you, double layer pelvic wall is there. Fibromuscular or mechanical support, uterine ascic, axis, antiversion, antiflexion of uterus, pubis cervical, that means the uterus, cervix of uterus attached to the pubic bones, transverse cervical ligaments of McEnroe, they are very strong ligaments and they attach the cervix to the lateral pelvic wall, and uterosacral ligaments, the cervix, it is attached to the sacrum, middle pieces of sacrum, and it pulls the uterus backwards. Round ligament, it is the fibrous ligament, which is 10 to 12 centimeter long, and it is attached to this, that means they just comes to this superolateral angle of uterus, and then it traverses to this inguinal canal, and then it merges with this areolar tissues in this filamentous structure in the labium majus. So as we are Ayurvedic students, we can come to know that the inguinal canal, which through which traverses in male spermatic cord, in female round ligaments of uterus, and the inguinal canal is nothing but the site of vitapamarma. So Sushruta given that alpashukrata shandhyam va. So shandhyam alpashukrata cha, he given that is effect after injury. So here we can come to know that spermatic cord means if it is get cut, there is no transportation of spermatozoa. But it, in female, how it comes, that is inguinal canal, it traverses the, or it conducts this round ligament of uterus, and if this ligament is going to cut or lax or it becomes injured, the uterus sac and that's why uterus becomes goes backward, that is retroverted uterus. And retroverted uterus, it is itself nothing but one cause or one reason of sterility. These are secondary supports in the ovary. I told you ovarian ligament as well as here, see, that is suspensory ligament, ovarian ligaments are there. And vagina, it is the fixed part, it is a sheath. That's why there are no such type of ligaments are there. So these are all the ligaments. Mostly you should remember the supports of uterus are very much important, especially primary supports.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
One more question, K. Ma'am, venous drainage and tamponiform plexus of ovary.
Ovary, okay, okay. See carefully, tamponiform venous plexus, it is present in both in male as well as female. Most probably in gonadal structures, this type of venous plexus is there. If we are going to dissect this spermatic cord, there we can come to know the veins emerge at the hilus of the ovary. Hilus means opening of the ovary, and they are forming tamponiform. That means it is nothing but a just like cluster-like structure is there. Hi, that means very thick network is there, and it is present around the artery there. And afterwards, it is going to drain. So this is nothing but venous drainage, that is tamponiform venous plexus. This type of large venous plexus, we can see in the spermatic cord in the male. If we have any way are doing the dissection, at that time we can get testicular artery, vas deferens, tamponiform venous plexus. We were coming out each, taking out each and every structure at the time of dissection of spermatic cord. So this is nothing but you should keep in your mind, tamponiform.
I hope there are no further queries, ma'am.
Yes, okay, okay. I just want to tell thanks. That means my gratitude to your college. Can I tell Anup? No problem?
Yeah, before that, I think I should thank you for giving your time to us, ma'am.
Okay, okay, okay. Huh?
So yes. On behalf of Department of Rachana Sharira and Shiva Ayurvedic Medical College, we thank you for very happily accepting our invitation to be a resource person in Rachana Sangama. We thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you for giving us this two time. I hope you had two wonderful days with our students.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Anup. Just I would like to thanks your management first for giving me chance, as well as I would like to thanks Harsha sir. He called me and he told me for this guest lecture. I am very much thankful to all of you, to your department, all the people who are just arranging this wonderful seminar. And I'd like to tell thanks to all the students, participants who just patiently listen my lecture. And from yesterday also, today also, I'm very much happy from all the students, because they ask very nice questions. And as possible as me, I just told. So as possible as me, I just presented my lecture. Thank you once again very much for giving me chance. Thank you, Anup.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Happy Teacher's Day.
Thank you. Same to you. Thank you.
So thank you. On this platform, I also want to tell that we are coming to an end of Rachana Sangamam.
Okay.
And we had 10 sessions in total.
Yes.
So in this occasion, I would like to thank our Managing Director, Engineer Purushottam Sharma, and also our Principal Dr. Harsha Ennam for providing all amenities and technical assistance which are required for conducting such kind of medical conference or webinar. And also I thank all teaching staff of Shiva Ayurvedic Medical College for their supports being given. I also would like to thank Dr. Bapil Sharma and also Dr. Kunik Singh Chauhan for all supports and helps which were given during the inaugural session of Rachana Sangama. I also thank all students from first year to fourth year BAMS of Shiva Ayurvedic Medical College for supporting this session by patiently hearing and even making the discussion session more active. I also thank non-teaching staff of Shiva Ayurvedic Medical College for all the supports which are being given. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you.
So, ma'am, with your permission, we are winding up this.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.